Hello dear students, in the last class we have discussed about how the diversity in the antibodies are generated, and we have seen that how in a specific clone of B cells a very specific and unique type of antibody is produced, which has its own variable region that identifies a specific antibody, a specific epitope of antigen, and how unique it is and how it is produced by a multitude of different mechanisms that we have seen. Today we will discuss on two different topics which are very, very important as far as the practical applications go. We will discuss them shortly, briefly, not in much detail, but both of these topics are very, very important. In the first topic, that is the monoclonal antibodies, it comes from the discussion that we have done in the last class, that how the antibody diversity is generated, and we have seen that a specific uniqueness of the specific antibody. So about one of such unique antibody that can be called as a monoclonal antibody, and how it can be produced artificially in our labs, and how we can use that we will discuss today. So firstly, we will discuss the basic idea and then preparation and application of that. So what are the monoclonal antibodies? As we can see in this diagram, as we have discussed in the last class also, that in one antigen you can see there can be different epitopes. So there can be different epitopes. You can see that there can be different epitopes. So all of these are different epitopes. So we have seen that this is one epitope, this is another epitope, and this is another epitope. So for all these specific epitopes, there are specific identifying antibody, and each of those specific antibodies we can call as monoclonal antibodies, because they will have to come from a specific clone of B cell, or a specific set of B cell, or a specific parent lineage of B cells, where a very unique set of combinations have occurred and a specific set of variable region has been formed. Okay, so with that, now we can say, so we can define the monoclonal antibodies as they are identical immunoglobulins that are generated from a single B cell clone, and obviously functionally they will recognize a very unique epitope, not only a unique antigen but a unique epitope. They will target it, they will specifically bind with a unique epitope. But actually, when an antigen is introduced into our body, what happens? That antigen has multiple epitopes. So the antibody response that is generated in our body is usually not monoclonal but polyclonal, where different clones of B cells will generate different specific monoclonal antibodies against specific epitopes of that same antigen. So it is rather difficult to produce or to get a monoclonal antibody just by generating the antibody response or immune response in our body, because if you start immune response, if you generate immune response, the antibody response is almost always polyclonal. Okay, so what are the characters? So that is the same thing, that they are identical, they are synthesized from a specific B cell clone, and they will specifically bind with a particular epitope of an antigen. Now what is interesting is some of the myeloma cells. Myeloma is a cancer of the B cells. So some of the, not B cells, but I should say plasma cells. So the antibody generating plasma cells, it is a cancer of those plasma cells, that is multiple myeloma. So now some myeloma cells will also be coming from only a single clone or lineage of plasma cells. So they will also generate, or they can also generate monoclonal antibody. Okay, so with these two informations, we will just use this information to generate, we will see that we will use this information to generate monoclonal antibody. I'll come to it later. Now just we can differentiate between them, that polyclonal and monoclonal antibody, this can also come in exam, that polyclonal antibodies, they will obviously come from different B cell clones and they will bind to multiple epitopes. So polyclonal antibodies, actually it is multiple different monoclonal antibodies that are together, and usually they will be, that is the polyclonal antibody response is the response that is generated in response to any antigen, which obviously has almost always multiple epitopes. Now polyclonal antibodies can be of different antibody classes that we you know already, and then they will bind to antibody binding sites, different epitopes. And so polyclonal antibodies can cross-react. The rate of cross-reaction of polyclonal antibody, one polyclonal antibody against one antigen can cross-react with another antigen because they may share some epitope with each other. But monoclonal antibody, since they are specific for epitopes, their rate of cross-reactivity with other antigens is very, very low. Okay. Now, briefly about the history of development, because we are more interested in how we can generate monoclonal antibody, because they have some very important practical uses. So Kohler and Milstein, these two scientists in 1975, first they were studying the clonal selection theory, and for that they have done an experiment where they have fused a normal B cell and a malignant cell and generated a cell known as hybridoma. So that was the hybridoma technology for which they have received the Nobel Prize in 1984. But from that hybridoma cells, we then found out that we can generate monoclonal antibody. And as soon as within 2 years, the first monoclonal antibody was licensed by the FDA in USA in 1986. Okay, and we will see what are the various types of use that can be different monoclonal antibodies can be used for. Okay. Now the most important thing, that is the preparation. Preparation and use, these are the two most important parts that you have to know about monoclonal antibodies. So as I have said, that this is synthesized by hybridoma technique. This is a very, very important topic as far as exam is concerned, hybridoma technique. So what is done in the hybridoma technique? In one sentence, it is the hybridoma cells are cells that are done by the fusion of B cells and myeloma cells. So you get a specific B cell from an immunized animal. That specific B cell will generate a specific type of antibody, and you fuse it with myeloma or the cancer cells, and after fusion of these two cells you generate the myeloma cells, generate the hybridoma cells, and that hybridoma cell will be your source of production of monoclonal antibodies. Okay, so how is it done? How this preparation is done? See what happens. At first, a particular animal is immunized. So what we do, we immunize the animal. So this is the animal, it has been immunized. You have given the antigen, you inject the animal, usually mice, you inject it with this specific antigen. So what will happen? Antibody forming B cells or plasma cells are formed. Now you get the myeloma cells, and these two cells you fuse together, and after fusion you get the hybridoma cells. So this hybridoma cells will have two different characters. It will have two characters. One character from the tumor cell or the myeloma cells, that is its very high rate of division, and it will get another character from the B cell or the plasma cells, that is the capability to generate a specific type of antibody, that is a monoclonal antibody. So production of monoclonal antibody comes from the B cell, and the very high rate of cell division comes from the tumor cells. So now you generate the hybridoma cells. How you fuse these two cells? By polyethylene glycol, by treating them with polyethylene glycol. Now you get the hybridoma cells, and in this hybridoma cells, they can be cloned to a very large number of cells. Rather easily they can be cloned to a large number of cells, and that specific cell will now give you a very specific type of monoclonal antibody. So you can use it for multiple purposes. So what are the purposes, we will see later. Okay. So now in very brief, if what are the steps? The steps are, first, as I said, they immunize the animal, then we isolate the spleen cells from where we get specific antibody producing B cells, and now we fuse it with the myeloma cells using polyethylene glycol or PEG, and now we produce the hybridoma cells. Now the problem is, in this, after this fusion, you can get some cells to fuse and some not to fuse. So you can get three types of cells as a result: unfused B cells, then you can get unfused myeloma cells, and then you can get hybridoma cells, that is after the fusion. That is what you need. Okay, so how can you just select the hybridoma cells from the two unfused cells? So for that you culture it in a medium known as HAT medium: hypoxanthine, aminopterin and thymidine. What happens, The aminopterin is an inhibitor. Aminopterin is an inhibitor of the de novo purine synthesis, which you must have read. So aminopterin is an inhibitor of de novo purine synthesis. So if you inhibit the de novo purine synthesis, the only purine synthesis pathway that is left is the salvage pathway. Now the problem is that the myeloma cells, they do not have the salvage pathway, and you are also providing hypoxanthine so that the salvage pathway can occur. And myeloma cells do not have the salvage pathway because they lack the enzyme, that is, they lack the enzyme that is HGPRT. So you are providing hypoxanthine. If you have HGPRT, you can go through the salvage pathway. So this is how we can also discuss how HAT medium acts. So aminopterin is a folate inhibitor, so it inhibits the de novo synthesis. Now myeloma cells, they will lack the HGPRT, so they cannot have the salvage pathway. So they, you inhibit the de novo pathway and they lack the salvage pathway. So the myeloma cells will die. So you had three options: unfused myeloma cells, unfused B cells, and the fused hybridoma cells. You want the hybridoma cells to survive, the rest to die. So you inhibit the de novo synthesis and they cannot do the salvage pathway, so the myeloma cells die. Now what remains is the hybridoma cells and the unfused B cells. Both can do the salvage pathway, but because the hybridoma cells have the character of the tumor cells, they can much rapidly divide. So they will outdivide the B cells. So they will divide in such a large rate, the B cells will lose out in the competition, and B cells will also eventually die. So the only cell that is selected is your target cells, that is the hybridoma cells. So your hybridoma cells are selected. So that is how HAT medium works. So let us come back. So you immunize the animal, you get the specific B cells, you fuse it with the myeloma cells using PEG to produce the hybridoma cell. You select the hybridoma cells using the HAT medium. Now, how you clone them? You get the hybridoma cells. So you clone them, one cell in one cloning well. You clone them like that. And after you have cloned them, so each clone will generate one specific monoclonal sets of hybridoma cells. So they will specifically generate one hybridoma cells. And you can, they will generate the specific antibody. So from the cell culture medium, from that particular clone of hybridoma cells, you can get that specific antibody and you can see whether that is the antibody, that is the monoclonal antibody you want or not. So you choose that clone only, that monoclonal, because you have cloned by one hybridoma cell, one set of hybridoma cell in one well. So when it has grown, it will obviously be a monoclonal, single clonal set of cells. So you select which antibody you want, and that particular clone you separate out and you culture it more and more, and you harvest your antibody as much as you want. So that is the simple but very elegant way by which the hybridoma cells are generated, and this hybridoma technique acts. Now when we generate different types of hybridoma cells and generate the monoclonal antibodies, now we can do it from the mice cells. So if it is 100% from the mural cells, then murine cells, then the monoclonal antibody, you will find that it ends with, the suffix is OMAB. Now we can genetically engineer it, and we engineer it with some of the elements of human antibody genes or human genes of immunoglobulins. So more and more human genes are incorporated, it becomes more and more humanized. So if it is 0% human, 100% murine, it is, all those monoclonal antibodies will end with OMAB. If it is chimeric, that is 65% is human, you can see the blue color, and rest is murine, then it will end with XIMAB. If it is 90% human but still around 10-15% murine, then it ends with ZUMAB. And if it is fully human, 100% human as far as the protein is concerned, then it ends with UMAP. And obviously the immunogenicity of the antibody itself, because antibody itself is a protein, if you introduce that antibody to the body of somebody, of a human being, that antibody can also be identified as a foreign protein and generate immune response. So if it is 100% human, fully human, ends with UMAP, then there will be immunogenicity is very low. But if it's 0% human or murine, if it ends with OMAP, then the immunogenicity will be high, because that antibody is murine antibody. So that antibody protein, immunoglobulin protein, can be identified as an antigen itself. So more you go towards humanized and human, the antigenicity of the antibody itself comes down to lower and lower levels. Okay. So now next most important thing is, what are the applications? So it can be used for various purposes. The first is, they can be used for diagnosis, biochemical analysis and imaging. Then they can be used for protein purification. And then most importantly, nowadays, this is the big field of research, that it can be used for therapeutically. Okay. So first, diagnostically, in clinical biochemistry, you have learned about the two very important processes, that is RIA and ELISA, radioimmunoassay and enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. I think you have learned these two methods in detail. And you have seen that in the wells of the ELISA plates, we first fix the antibodies to which the specific antigen that you want to measure will be fixed. So all those antibodies, most of them are monoclonal antibodies. So if you want to measure TSH, you have an antibody against TSH and to which your TSH protein will bind, and then you bind with other antibodies and with radioisotope or with an enzyme, you generate color, etc., etc. But monoclonal antibodies are absolutely vital in these processes, and you can measure many things. You can measure hormones, you can measure cytokines, you can measure cancer markers and many other things by these methods. So this is number one. Then diagnostic imaging. Specific antibodies can be tagged with specific radioisotopes, like say iodine-131, and that antibody will go and bind to a specific tissue where that antigen is present. So you target that, you generate an antibody targeting a specific tissue protein. So that antibody will go and bind to that tissue, and that antibody has radioisotope tagged, so there will be radiation. You can get the radiation and you can diagnostically image that tissue. So maybe if that is a cancer tissue abnormally producing, so if it binds to that tissue, so you can diagnose cancer like that. And then protein purification, from a mixture of protein, if you want to separate one very specific protein, you generate monoclonal antibodies against that protein. Only that protein will bind to your antibodies, rest will wash out, and you can then separate out that specific protein. So it can also be used for protein purification. And most importantly, it can be used for many therapeutic agents. For infection, you can give it, it can specifically bind to your pathogen and then help in opsonization and then phagocytosis. For immunosuppression against specific cytokines, etc., you can do. And against different types of cancer, many proteins that are specifically express on some cancers, you can target antibodies, monoclonal antibodies against them, so they will only go and bind with the cancer cells and not with any other cells, and then that cancer cells can be destroyed by your white cells or otherwise. Okay, so now every year many patents are being taken and drugs are being generated which are actually monoclonal antibodies. And you can see, they can be interleukin inhibitors, they can be anti-VEGF, TNF blocker, EGFR antagonist, etc., etc., many types. And proportions have been given in this diagram. And mostly you can see 43% around are against the autoimmune diseases, that is, they are the immune suppressants, and 36% are against cancer. These are the two biggest groups against which the monoclonal antibodies are currently in use. I will just give you some of the examples which are very highly used. So you can see abciximab, which is an inhibitor of GP2B3A. You know, this is a particular protein on the platelet. So it is a platelet aggregation inhibitor used in the percutaneous coronary intervention. Then infliximab, this is a TNF-alpha inhibitor and used in various diseases which involves the immune destruction of different tissues like rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's disease, etc. Then omalizumab, which is an inhibitor of IgE, which is associated with the hypersensitivity, allergy. So it is used in treatment for severe asthma. Rituximab is a CD20 inhibitor and used in particular types of non-Hodgkin lymphoma, which is a cancer. Then trastuzumab, which again targets a specific protein on breast cancer cells, that is HER2-neu. So it is used in some types of breast cancer cells. Then cetuximab, which is an EGFR antibody against the EGFR. So it targets EGFR, and EGFR is a factor that helps in the metastasis of certain cancers. So in metastatic colorectal carcinoma, we can use this. And then finally, tocilizumab, which is an inhibitor of the IL-6 receptor, interleukin-6. Interleukin-6 is a specific cytokine, again which is associated with inflammation and specific inflammatory diseases. So it's also can be used in the rheumatoid arthritis. But most interestingly, you can, if you focus on tocilizumab, it inhibits the IL-6 receptors, and IL-6, you know, is a cytokine that is very, very strongly associated with the immune response or the cytokine storm that occurs in the coronavirus. So nowadays, in some of the very severe cases of coronavirus, you may have read in the newspapers or in the heard in the news channels that tocilizumab is one of the very important drugs that are being tried in these disorders, in the very severe cases of coronavirus infection. So that I found you may be a little bit interesting. But another thing you notice here, that some of the monoclonal antibodies are ending with XMAb, some with ZUMAb, etc. So now you know which one is ZUMAb, so that may be humanized. XMAb, that may be chimeric, etc. So what are the different kinds of, depending on how much of human kind of protein is there, that we have already discussed. So this is about the monoclonal antibody. Another topic that we need to discuss a little bit, that is vaccine production. And this also is a very, very hot topic nowadays, because we are all waiting for vaccines to be generated for the coronavirus. Okay, so overall, we will give you a short idea about what vaccines are, what are the different types of vaccines, and how they are usually generated. So this term vaccine came from Latin varioli vaccini, which is cowpox. And the first vaccination that was developed, you may have heard, may have read somewhere, that was Edward Jenner in way back in 1798, when he has shown that this pox, if it is introduced into the body, then you get a mild disease, but you generate an immunity which can give you protection against the smallpox, which was a lethal disease at that time. Okay, so then for the first time, the idea of vaccination, that you introduce some pathogen or pathogenic part or its protein, so to generate a immune response in your body, so that later you can get a protection from that particular disease. Okay, so what they do, so typically what we do, we are not introducing the pathogen as such, because then we are introducing the disease itself, but we introduce the pathogen in an inactivated or weakened form. So the antibody response or the immune response is generated, which will stay and which will give protection for later infections, but the disease does not occur in the full-fledged manner. So that antigens, we are introducing the antigens, not the entire pathogens, so the antibodies or the immune response is generated. Okay, so in short, there are mainly four types of vaccines: live vaccine, dead vaccine, subunit vaccine, and genetically engineered vaccine. Okay, so live but attenuated vaccine, you can give the microorganism live, but you have to attenuate or you have to weaken. So here the pathogen is given live, but it is weakened, so the infection is not sufficient, infection is not dangerous enough, but the immune response has to be sufficient enough. Okay, so sufficient to induce an immune response, but insufficient to cause the disease. Okay, so first we grow the pathogen in a foreign host, such as animal or embryonated eggs or tissue culture, and then we convert it or attenuate it to a less virulent, less harmful form. One of the example is MMR, which is a very common vaccine that is routinely given, that is mumps, measles, and rubella. Okay, then killed vaccines. Now some microorganisms you just cannot attenuate enough and you cannot give it life, so you kill that vaccine, kill that organism, and then you give that particular thing as vaccine. So it is killed, the microorganism, that bacteria or virus is killed, it cannot produce the disease, but still the proteins are present, so the immune response is generated. One of the inactivated vaccine example is IPV. Okay, then subunit vaccine, not the entire protein, not live, not even killed, just some parts of the microorganism, that is some part, maybe some proteins or some parts, some lipoproteins, etc., some parts of that organism you are only giving. So that is known as subunit vaccine. The example is influenza vaccine. Okay, And then finally, by genetically recombinating different types of genes and some parts of a particular protein with a humanized thing, with another antigen, one particular protein or microbe you can use as a vector. Say a less virulent microbe you are using as a vector. So that less virulent microorganism you are giving injection or introducing into the body. But the particular disease that you are want to prevent, some of the proteins or some of the subunits of that particular organism you are genetically modifying and adding to that vector. So now you can give that vector as a host, or also you can genetically engineer a vector that can express the antigen, can generate sufficient antigen, and that antigen you can later give as a subunit vaccine. So these two can be done. And nowadays DNA can be also used as specific, DNA can also be used as vaccines, and these are known as the DNA vaccines. They can be given by different methods. We will not go into much detail of that, but one important thing is that DNA vaccines can generate both humoral and cellular immunity. I think you by now know a little bit about the main two types of immunity, that is humoral through the antibody and cellular by specific cytotoxic T cells. Okay. So then there are another thing that is known as cocktail vaccine, when in one vaccine you give more than one particular protection against more than one particular disease. And the classical example will be MMR, which is against three specific diseases, three specific microorganisms, mumps, measles and rubella. And this is routinely given to every child that is born in our country. Okay. So how do you produce vaccine? What are the steps? Very briefly, first you select a particular strain of that microorganism. You grow that microorganism, that isolate and purify that microorganism or its protein. Then you inactivate if you are giving the attenuated live vaccine, or you kill it if you are giving a killed vaccine, or you separate the subunit. And then you produce the vaccine by adding other things, etc. And then finally, as a final product, you release it. Okay. So you can grow the microorganism, if it is bacteria, by batch culture and continuous culture. If it is a virus, then you can do by cell culture, barred embryo, or live animal inoculation. By different methods, you can grow the viruses also. Then inactivation. How you inactivate or attenuate the microorganism? You can do it by adding specific detergents or solvents. You can do it by pasteurization, by lowering the pH, making it acidic, or by using ultraviolet rays. So these are the some of the major ways. You just know the names, that how inactivation or attenuation can be done. Okay. And finally, there is another thing. Some of the vaccines by themselves, it does not have much of the immunogenicity. You have attenuated it so much that it is not generating disease, but it is also not generating too much of immune response. But you want the immune response to be generated. So for that, we add something that can help to generate the immune response more sufficiently. Those things are known as adjuvants that can be added to some vaccines. And one of the most common adjuvant is aluminium salt, that is alum, that we called in our local language fatkiri, that is alum. So that can be added, not in that raw way, but there are some chemical methods that you can add that adjuvant or enhancer, so enhance the immune response. And this adjuvant addition is done in inactivated polio virus, in Haemophilus influenzae virus, in hepatitis A virus, etc., etc. So this is in short about what you need to know about vaccines. What is vaccine? How they act? What are the different types of vaccines? One example each. Then how you produce the vaccine stepwise? What is the attenuation? What is adjuvant? I think that would be sufficient for you. Okay. Thank you very much.